sutil clarea. Lo que erguido se alzó cuando el sol se ocultaba y sus franjas y estrellas en el rudo luchar sobre recio baluarte gallardón ondulaba y la bomba lanzar su rojiza explosión en la noche dio a ver que allí estaba el pendón. El pendón estrellado tremola feliz en la tierra del valor.
From sea to Amen. Praise God. How many of you guys are happy to be here this morning? Amen. I know I am. It seems like some people are probably staying away because of what's happening, and that's okay. I missed you guys last week. I was out camping and seeing God's creation out there. It was awesome. It was beautiful. Just to be able to spend that time out there and just see what, I mean, just everything that was there. I mean, the creek, the water, took a dip in the creek. It was amazing. This week, I just want to share this verse with you. I think with a lot that's going on, a lot of people, how many of you guys know that the media likes to instill fear in people? Amen? But that's not what we're held by, right? That's not what we live by. We live by God. We live by what his word tells us. It says in John 10:10, it says, "The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I have come that you may have life and have it to the full." Now, also in Mark 11:24, it says, "Therefore I tell you, whatever you ask for in prayer, believe that you have received it, and it will be yours." So I'm here to tell you this morning that no matter what has happened, whether you've had a test, whether you've had not a test, whether you've had symptoms, whether you've not had symptoms, no matter what, the thief comes to instill that fear. But God has come to give you life and life more abundantly. And know that no matter what, when we present that to God, believing, we will receive it. Amen? God didn't give us a spirit of fear. He gave us a spirit of power, love, and a sound mind. Amen? And that's what we stand on today. Amen? Dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you, God, this morning. I thank you, God, for who you are, Lord, in our lives. I thank you, God, because we can stand on that rock, sure and firm, Lord God, knowing that you are there with us, Father, knowing that you are walking with us, Father, knowing that we have nothing, absolutely nothing to fear, Lord. Father, I thank you, Lord, because you have paid that price for us, Lord. You have dealt with that fear for us, God. Father, and I just pray that this morning, Lord, we would stand on the rock, Father. We would stand on your word, Lord Jesus, of who you are, God. I pray, God, for those that are struggling with it, Lord, in the name of Jesus, I cast out fear right now, Lord, in their lives, Father. I cast out doubt in their lives right now, God. Father, I just pray, Lord, that you would give them the sense of security, the sense of just of knowing, Lord, that you are there, God. In Jesus' name, Father, I pray, God, that this morning, Lord, we would just worship you and praise you, God. In Jesus' name.
Praise God. So we claim joy in God's house. Amen. Let's continue to worship Jesus and celebrate the joy that comes from heaven. Hallelujah. We worship you, Jesus. Sing with me.
And there is joy in the house of the Lord. There is joy in the house of the Lord.
There is joy in the house of the Lord. There is joy.
seated as Pastor comes forward and shares the announcements with you. Praise God.
Amen. Good morning. So good to have all of you here. I'm glad that you guys have made it. I didn't think you could get any lower than last week, but apparently there's a breakout. I want to just quote the mayor from Los Angeles, who said over the last 2 weeks we've had a major breakout. What happened in the last 2 to 3 weeks? There was riots and there was demonstrations all over his city. This is the mayor of Los Angeles who said this. I have a water, Jalika, I'm good. I think in our church we have 7 people that are either testing or in the process. We know we have 2 for sure that have it, that got it. They haven't been here in 14 days, so you're good, you're safe. My family and I have been around them, so we were quarantined until today. Today's our first day out. I had to send people to get this stuff. I get to go out, and I can't wait to go to a restaurant. We closed, so I can't do that now. Told my wife, what are we going to do? Is it takeout or something? So we've been quarantined. We've been suffering there at the house with a pool, albeit, but still suffering. With air conditioning, but still suffering. With quads, but still suffering. But I tell my wife, it's quarantined. It's not all it's expected. I have people that called me today and told me how they were feeling, and I said, don't come. So I literally told several people not to come today. They had a cough, and they had a something, and I think it's just safer for them not to be here. You see everybody wearing a mask. We're singing with masks on. The people on the stage are more than 20 feet from the people in front of them. They're 6 feet apart, except for the 2 that live in the same household. They're together. So it looks a little different. And you guys might be wondering what's going on. If you're looking online, you're like, hey, what's going on over there? There's a lot of people missing them because they're fighting this. So it's been a second wave, it looks like. So how many of you believe that you're washed in the blood of the Lamb? Say amen. The brother that has it says, Pastor, it's just like having a cold. It's just persistent. He says, by the way, for those that don't know, sister from church just tested negative today, and she's not here because of that, her son. But they got tested. Because you know who I'm talking about, she tested negative. She just checked right now, I mean, right before we started. Hey, I'm negative. I think that's good. But it's tough. It's tough. We're living in tough times. We're living in difficult times. But we have to do things differently. We can't just do the things the same anymore. So you see in front of you, you'd say, Pastor, there's nobody in front of me. Why do I have to wear the mask? If we get caught with people not wearing the mask, they will find the church. They will find us, not you. So technically, they say that when you sing or you chant, that your little things that come out your mouth, the little gremlins, they'll reach 20 to 12 to 15 feet. So, you know, I look at Manuela, I should get it on Sister Annie. So please don't open your ding and just start singing really loud over the sister. So we really appreciate that. The announcements are what we've been doing since we started back in March. Monday, Kids Club, Kids Connection. If you do not have your email to Christina and Daniel, make sure you get them your email so that your kids can join at 7 o'clock on Mondays. Tuesday, Restoring Freedom meets. You just need to talk to Brother David to see where they're at, because sometimes they're here, sometimes they're somewhere else. You never know where they're going to be at. So you need to talk to Brother David. If you don't have his cell number, you can get a hold of my cell number, and it's on the website, and it's on the church bulletins that we don't hand out anymore. So where do they get my cell number? Call the church, leave me a message. Right now in the comments on the YouTube, you can write in the comments, this is my contact information. I would like to join Restoring Freedom or Celebrating Freedom. Restoring Freedom. Whatever you want to call it. If you need freedom, you need to come 5:30 on Tuesdays. Also, Sister Kathy's doing hers. She started a new book. Talk to Kathy if you haven't got a vibe with that, for the ladies in Restoring Freedom. The Women's Bible Study is going through a book by Joyce Myers. They're meeting at 7 o'clock on Tuesdays on Zoom. If you haven't given me your email, I can't invite you to join the sisters on Zoom, so make sure you do that. Wednesday night is the family service. We do it on Zoom. but also on YouTube. I was really excited this week that we had the whole screen full of people, and there was a lot of people watching on Zoom. I thought that was good. So that's Wednesday night at 7. Thursday, Iron Man at 6 o'clock. We had a whole screen of men again. It was really good. So if you're not getting involved with this stuff, I just got to ask you, what are you doing? Where are you at? What are you getting involved with if you're not? Because if you heard Daniel, that there's just the news just wants to scare you. The media just wants to scare you. I'm actually thanking God for social media. Ever since our family has moved back over to here, my sister-in-law Rocky and her friend Danny are constantly showing me some really funny stuff on media. They showed me one yesterday of who the baby. I'm gonna be preaching today, and I'm not speaking in tongues when I say who the baby, but social media, which I used to think was of the devil, is actually being used right now to spread the gospel and keep people informed and in touch. So I hope that you're using your social media responsibly to encourage people and make us laugh, all right? I begged my wife to let me get a Facebook, but she says, no, we're not gonna get a Facebook. She won't let me get a Facebook. I really want a Facebook because I think I'm missing out on who the baby is. So I wanna see stuff like that. So if you got jokes, send them to me. You have my email, my cell phone, you can text message it. Something we've started doing is praying for the offering. We hadn't been doing that, and I apologized to you guys a few weeks ago. Today is Communion Sunday, but we really are not going to risk it this time. It's over there. You guys are saying, why isn't that table over here? Why aren't we doing Communion Sunday? Because this is getting really serious. So we just need to be careful and not do that. You can give thanks every time you eat, and you can recognize the blood and the body of Jesus. Every time you eat, you say, Lord, thank you. Thank you for your sacrifice. Thank you for what you've done. So I know it's better when we all do it together. But I want to pray for the offering. I know some of you that are giving online. Some of you are giving in the back on the little swiper. Some of you actually bring your offerings and leave them here. Some of you mail them. Some of you drop them off at my house or here. We really appreciate that. We just want to say thank you that you continue to give to the house of the Lord. Let's bow our heads and pray. Lord, we thank you for your goodness, your kindness, your mercy, your grace. We thank you that through all of this, you have been right there with us. I don't think there's a single person here that could say, I've not felt the presence of God through what's going on. And God, I think of way back March 16th when we said we were no longer going to meet. And we met that one last time together as a church and then stopped for 2.5 months. In all of that time, God, your people have been faithful because you've been faithful to them. They've been able to give because you've given to them, and we thank you for that. God, if there's anybody in our midst that is in need, please bring it to my attention so we can help them. If there's anybody who's part of this church who's struggling right now, help us to come alongside them at a time like this. God, we thank you for all of the tithes and all of the offerings that have been brought into this house, that have been sent to this house, to have been sent to your house. God, I pray that we would continue to honor it as holy because it is yours. The minute they've given it, it's become holy. And I thank you, God, that we've been able to comply with the holiness that is your offerings and your tithes. God, I pray right now that you would bless those who are about to give or who have given during the week and are getting ready to give. Lord, I pray that you would give them a tenfold reward for what they're doing for your house. Lord, I pray that if there's somebody listening right now online or here that says, I cannot give, Pastor, I pray in the name of Jesus, God, that you would give them the ability to do so. I pray that you would bless them with health and you would bless them with work. God, we thank you because it seems like my kids can just find 2 and 3 jobs when they look for them. We know that's got to be your hand that's upon our community, and you've provided work. So thank you, God, for giving us the ability to work. Thank you for giving us the work, and thank you for allowing us to give back to you from so much that you give us. God, bless those who have given during the week. Bless those who are about to give. In your name I pray, amen. So the offerings will be here when we dismiss after the service. You're welcome to come down and give the offering. Remember to follow the arrows. Keep your mask on. And there's signs to follow and things to do throughout the church. Those of you watching, make sure you wash your hands. If you're online, I know you're probably sitting there chewing on your nails right now. That's nasty. You shouldn't be doing that right now, especially if you ain't taking a shower and brush your teeth yet. Get in the shower after the service. God bless you, Sister Annie.
So for those of us that are here, let's stand and let's continue to worship Jesus. I want to just read something to you. I've been looking up some quotes about the mind because we've been studying the battlefield of the mind. So I found this quote, and I shared it with the ladies, I think, this last Tuesday. It says, whatever you hold in your mind will tend to occur in your life. If you continue to believe as you have always believed, you will continue to act as you have always acted. If you continue to act as you have always acted, you will continue to get what you've always gotten. If you want different results in your life or your work, all you have to do is change your mind. So today, I choose to make God the king of my heart. How many of you are grateful that God can be the king of your heart this morning? Amen? So Jesus, we want to just worship you, God. And we want to choose today, God, for my brothers and sisters that are here with me in God's house, in your house, Lord, and for those that are watching. I pray in Jesus' name that for some reason or another, their mind has been filled with fear. I pray, God, that you take that away and that you become the king of their mind. Because, God, when you surround my mind, God, when you saturate my mind with your love and your forgiveness and your grace, then everything is okay and I am happy, I'm full of peace, and I have unspeakable joy. We love you, Jesus, because these worship songs, God, remind us that you are the king, you are the Lord, you are the doctor, you are the faithful one, and I can do all things because you are the king of my heart. Let's sing this song together. We worship you, God. And let the king of my heart be the mountain where I run, the fountain I drink from, oh, he is my soul. And let the king of my heart be the shadow where I hide, the mantle for my life, oh, he is my song, and you are good. Jesus Christ, to come to your house or wherever I am during the week to say, to worship you I live, my God, because you're never going to let me down. No No matter what comes my way, I can do it, and I will get through it, and this too will pass, and I will continue to have faith, and I will continue to trust my Maker in heaven. Forgive me, Jesus, if I have not shown you that I have faith in you. When anxiety and worry, God, comes my way, that is the enemy, and we cast it. We tell the enemy that you are under our feet because Jesus is with me, because Jesus lives inside of me. And I pray, God, that as we continue to live our life every day, not knowing what can come tomorrow, God, that we remember that you're never going to let us down. So I want you to lift your hands with me this morning. If you live to worship Jesus, I just want you to say these words. To worship you, my God, I live. To love you, I live. To live for you, God, I live. We love you this morning, Jesus. Hallelujah.
I live to worship you.
Everything that's happening, God. Some of us do, some of us don't. But God, I do know one thing for certain. Nobody is going to stop me from lifting my hands and using my voice and worshiping the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. That is the right that you gave me, Father, when you sent your Son on the cross to die for me. God, it is the blood of Jesus that covers us every day. So I pray that you continue to bless us, my God. With the passion, God, and the desire to give you the honor, to give you the glory. Come what come, God. When the devil comes and attacks my home, Jesus Christ, I will claim victory. And I will say that the blood of Jesus is in the center of my home. And nothing will stop me from serving my God. We love you this morning, Jesus. And we just pray, God, that you receive this worship as a very special gift. We love you, Lord, in your name I pray. And everyone together says, amen. Give God a loud hand clap if you love Jesus. We love you, Jesus. Amen. You may all be seated. God bless you.
It's really dusty over there. There were some dust bunnies and stuff over there flying around. Kind of messed me up a little bit right there, the dust. To Mama Beatriz too. Well, actually, it's not Mama Beatriz anymore. It's Manuela. Manuela has taken over the being the custodian of the church. We'll come up with a really cool title for Manuela. She's in training this week. Today we end Sunday with Esther. Wednesday we will end chapter 10. But the Bible says, and you're not going to see this verse because I didn't give it to Martha, but in Psalm 119:45, the Bible says, I will walk around in freedom. I will walk about in freedom. For I have sought out your precepts. Psalms 119:45. I will walk about in freedom. How many want to live in freedom? Say amen. There is no freedom like the freedom that Jesus can give you. Yesterday we were blessed. We are blessed to live in the greatest nation in the world. I've been to a lot of places and they don't come close to this place. This is the greatest nation in the world. And yesterday we were fortunate and blessed to celebrate Independence Day. I hope you all enjoyed your 4th of July, your Independence Day, the day we celebrate the independence of our nation from Great Britain. There were 4th of July celebrations all over the place, from the White House to my house. You guys know me, I was swimming and eating hot dogs. I was eating hamburgers. And then my family showed up, and now when I say family, it's not just Daniel. Rocky and her family showed up, and they brought a little class to the party because they brought shish kebabs. So we were all like gringos. We had shish kebabs on the grill and corn. And at one point, Rocky goes, this looks like a 4th of July grill. I go, no, it looks like a gringo grill. Where's the carne asada? But it was just a good time to be celebrating our independence, our freedom as a nation. But you know me, I sat out there and I watched all the crazy country people's free fireworks. How many of you had free fireworks in your neighborhood? Say amen. It was like a war zone. I didn't even want to go outside. And seriously, we heard automatic gunfire and semi-automatic gunfire. It was all coming from Fresno, not from Clovis. Every once in a while from Clovis, you'd hear a little poof. You're like, oh, there's a firework. Fresno was ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta, poof. It was awesome. Daniel, it's really loud. You can take me out of all the oxes. We're blessed. We're not the ox that goes to the camera. we're blessed to be free. We're blessed that we can celebrate freedom as a nation. But you know what? The biggest freedom you and I have is that which Jesus Christ gave us from a life of sin and death. You've been set free. We sang that song, "There is freedom. There is freedom in the house of the Lord." Some of you are like, "Oh, that's really quick. That's really good for you to sing, Pastor. I'm at home." Well, I hope your house is a house of the Lord. I hope that there's freedom in your house. I hope that your house is a place that welcomes those who love the Lord, who serve the Lord. I hope that your house, when you get there, you feel freedom. That when you get to your house, you don't feel like you're bound by the chains. Every once in a while, I would jokingly tell my kids, I would look at them and I'd say, "You guys are a bunch of dream killers." I would look at them and say, "Dream killer." And they would laugh. And about the second or third time I said it, they said, "Okay, that's not funny no more, Dad." But I hope when you see your family, you see, look at the freedom God has given me to have a family, to raise a family, to be able to take care of my family, love on my family, to raise them in the ways of the Lord. When you look at your spouse, when you look at your loved ones, you say, "I see freedom." We don't believe in the ball and chain. We don't believe that when you get married, that it's a ball and chain. We don't believe that. You have freedom to love someone the way Christ loved you. You should be surrounded by freedom. If we look at Esther chapter 9, it is the celebration of their freedom. The celebration that they were delivered. How many of you have ever been delivered? Say amen. How many of you know somebody that needs to be delivered? Say amen. I want to remind you that Jesus said some demons only come out with fasting and praying. But the rest of them, just lay hands on them and say, "I set you free." In Esther chapter 9, verse 1, we see where God gives the people of God, the Jewish people, their freedom. It was on the 13th day, this is Esther 9:1. On the 13th day of the 12th month, the month of Adar, the edict commanded by the king was to be carried out. Now, the original edict was all the Jewish people could be killed and robbed. Kill them and take whatever you want, because that's how Haman wrote it. On this day, the enemies of the Jews had hoped to overpower them. How many know the enemy can't overpower you? Say amen. I know that some of you have heard it said by some uneducated people that God will never give you more than you can handle. I want to tell you that that is a lie, and that is not true. Because if you could handle everything by yourself, what would you need God for? There are things you're going to go through in this life that if God doesn't hold you by the hand, some of you have that painting in your house of the footprints, and it says it's two footprints, and it says, "Jesus, why was there only one footprint after the two footprints when I started having trouble?" And Jesus says, "Because I was carrying you." But you see, we're from the barrio, and people try to insult us with that word, the barrio, but I'm not insulted from the barrio, because a barrio means neighborhood. It's just a Hispanic word for where we're from. So I'm not insulted by that. But what I want you to understand is something. When we have trouble, it's not him carrying us. You see his footprints, and then where he's dragging us along, because sometimes we got to go kicking and screaming. But you will go through things that will overpower you. On this day, the enemies of the Jews had hoped to overpower them. But now the tables were turned. I want you to look at somebody and say, "Jesus can overturn the tables in your life." Tell somebody right now, "Jesus can overturn the tables in your life." They were turned, and the Jews got the upper hand over those who hated them. I'm here to tell you this morning that those people who have come against you, those people who hate you, those racist people who discriminate, those people who just hate, they hate you because they ain't you. I want to tell you this morning, Jesus can turn the tables on them, and their hatred can go on them. There's all sorts of racism, people. We've been beating up on all the white folks for too long. They are black racists. And there are brown racists too. Oh, I didn't get an amen there. I hope somebody at home said amen. There are brown racists and there are black racists. When you don't like people that are not the same color as you, you're a racist. If you hate them, you're a racist sinner on your way to hell. That's all I got to say about that. I have spoken. The enemy had planned to annihilate the Jewish people on that day, but instead, the people of God had a victory. The verse literally says the tables were turned on the people that had come against the people of God. Now, this did not just happen by circumstance. This did not happen by chance. It happened because the people of God had fasted and they had prayed. They had sought God and God delivered them. They fasted. They drew near to God. They gave him the dedication, and the inspiration was given to them by God to say, you can overcome your enemies. Some of you are not having victory because you're not willing to pay the price. Some of you are not being victorious over your enemies because you're not willing to bend a knee. Some of you are still struggling because you have not fasted. And let me tell you, if you haven't fasted, it ain't bad enough yet. You and I are susceptible to the plans of the enemy. I said last week, the devil cannot touch us, and he cannot touch us. We are washed in the blood. We are children of the Lamb. But that doesn't mean that his minions aren't going to try. There are people out there. There are people out there right now that are being used by Satan to try to discourage you, to try to bring you down, to help some of you lose your Christianity. Some of you are just barely saved. And the wrong look and the wrong word can cause you to lose your Christianity. You need to be careful. I don't know how many people have told me, Pastor, I'm in a jam. I don't know how many people have told me, Pastor, I feel like I'm under attack. I don't know how many people tell me, Pastor, it feels like my world is just falling down all around me. People tell me, Pastor, every step I take forward is followed by two backwards. They say, Pastor, I can't seem to enjoy the good things in my life because the devil won't let me. I want to tell you, you need to quit talking to the pastor and start talking to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. I love what Dr. Binion said last year from this pulpit. He said, if you haven't fasted, then it ain't bad enough yet. I have a question for you. What's the last thing that brought you to your knees? What's the last thing that had you trembling before the Lord saying, if you don't take this away, if you don't change this, if you don't turn the tables, I don't know if I can continue. I don't know if I can go on any longer. Now, don't get me wrong. I believe as believers, you and I are called to move from glory to glory. But that don't mean that from this glory to the next glory, there ain't going to be some challenges. There ain't going to be some things that are going to make us want to get down on our knees. When's the last time you poured out your soul to God the Father in heaven? When's the last time that you cried until there was no tears left? Just like the people of God in Esther's day, God is wanting to turn the table on your enemies. But he's not going to do it for you if you're not willing to put in the work that is necessary. Remember in our family, and Annie and Rocky, remember this? Annie and I had just got married. I think Rocky was still single, and the oldest in the family had gone through something really challenging, and three or four of the other kids were going through something really difficult. I remember the oldest, Nellie, said these words to us. She said, it's our time to get our testimonies. She said, we've been living on the testimonies of mom and dad for too long. It's time we have our victories. So that means we're going to have struggles. I'll never forget when she said that. I don't know if it was a Christmas or we were all together. And I'll never forget when she said, we need to become mom and dad. I'm 51 years old now. And for too long, yeah, well, 4-1 is all I got to say. For too long, I've been living on the stories of my mom. And for too long, I've been living on the stories of my dad. For too long, I've been just depending on the knees that my mom bends in the morning. And I'm here to tell you that at 51 years old, it's time I take mom and dad's place. It's time that people say, nobody prays like my dad prays. Nobody prays like my mom prays. We were here, and we're here because the prayers of a mother and a father. Well, even though your mother's still around or your father's still around, you up in years, it's time you start bending a knee. It's time you become the praying mother. It's time you become the praying father. We can't live forever on the prayers of mom and dad. The tables were turned on their enemies because for 3 days they went without food and water and sought the Lord. I'm going to be honest with you. I don't think I can go 24 hours without food and water. I don't think I could go from 7 a.m. to the next 7 a.m. without food and water. I don't think I can. And I think I'm a pretty spiritual person. I just don't think I can do it. They went 3 days. I'm going to tell you something. Problems can get big enough, and guess what? You will do it. The last person I knew that did it was Ralph. Way back in the day, back in the 2000s. Brother Ralph did it for 7 days. I think by the third or fourth day he had to have water, but he did it. It can be done. Now, I don't hope that any of us go through something so drastic that we have to do that. But I pray that if called upon, we can. If the situation calls, could we? So after this great victory where the tables are turned, and this is very important, and this is the whole sermon right here, Esther chapter 9, verse 20 through 22. In Esther chapter 9, verse 20 through 22, it says that Mordecai recorded all these events. There was a bunch of events. On that day when the enemy was supposed to kill all the Jews, the Jews turned the tables on the enemy. And they actually defended themselves and killed a lot of the enemy. But they wouldn't touch the plunder. When all this happened, Mordecai recorded these events. Remember, he's now the right hand of the king. He sent letters to all of the Jews throughout the province of King Xerxes, near and far. And he said to them, celebrate. He said to them, celebrate. He said to them, celebrate. I know Pastor Mark remembers this song. Celebrate, Jesus, celebrate. Da, 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 da. Danny, I know you remember that song. Celebrate, Jesus. How many remember that song? All right. The older Christians. Some of the younger Christians are like, I know Celebration by Cooling the Gang. Come on. Da, da, da. I see you. You're like, is he singing Cooling the Gang? That's not Cooling the Gang. That's, what's his name? The African-American guy. Not Carmen. Ron Canole. It has to be Ron Canole. Or Maranatha. It's Carmen. My kids. Well, at least they know Carmen, praise the Lord. Celebrate, Jesus, celebrate. I mean, he said, celebrate. And not just right now, annually celebrate. On the 14th and the 15th day of the month of Adar, as the time when the Jews got relief from their enemies, and the same month when their sorrows were turned into joy, and their mourning into celebration, he wrote them to observe these days as days of feasting and joy, and giving presents of food to one another and gifts to the poor. So he told them, I want you to celebrate. He called it Purim, by the way. He said, I want you to celebrate what God did. You know what? Too often we forget what God did for us. When we first bought this building, it was August 21st when we signed the papers and it became ours, of 2011. On August 21st of 2011, God gave us this building. So on August 21st of 2012, we celebrated that God gave us this building. On August 21st of 2013, we celebrated again. And then we forgot in 2014. But we remembered in 2015. And then we haven't celebrated since 2015 that God gave us this place. Let me tell you something. If we celebrate birthdays, shouldn't we celebrate the house of the Lord? Or are your birthdays more important than the house of the Lord? Just recently, May 31st, we celebrated Pentecost, the birth of the church. Something's wrong when you don't celebrate and commemorate when God did something huge in your life. It's easy to look at the food and look at the gifts, look at the sorrow turned to joy, and miss the entire point. Mordecai wanted them to never forget what God had done for them on that day. You can't celebrate what the Lord has done if you don't remember it. How many of you remember the day you were saved? Say amen. Okay. Michael says, VBS 2005. Do you remember the day you were saved? Do you remember the date? Do you remember the church? Do you remember the sermon? Everybody's talking in the church. I don't know what you're doing at home. You remember it, but do you celebrate it? Do you celebrate when that happened? Do you celebrate when you were healed? Do you celebrate when your children came to the Lord? Do you celebrate when God healed or provided a home or God provided this? We bought our house on January 31st of 2015. And Annie says it's our forever home. I'm eyeing the mansion down the street, but she likes our house. Do we celebrate it? Do we commemorate it? If God did it, then celebrate it. Some of you are saying, well, Pastor, we don't have a chance to celebrate. We don't have a chance to. I was talking to my wife this morning. I remember growing up in the church, and every weekday service, we had something called testimonios. How many remember testimonios? Amen. Testimonios. Every adult would stand up and say, le quiero dar gracias al Señor porque me salvó de mis pecados, me perdonó mis pecados y me salvó, me bautizó en las aguas y en el Espíritu Santo. They said that. Every single adult that got up and said that. They said, I mean, word for word, I wrote it down. Le quiero dar gracias al Señor por la salvación de mi alma y el perdón de mis pecados. They would say that. We would make fun of them. We would look at each other. Oh, sister so-and-so. Le quiero dar gracias al Señor por la salvación de mi alma y el perdón de mis pecados. We would literally mimic them. We would go home making fun of them, saying, hey, sister so-and-so. Hey, what about brothers? There was always a brother who had to go on and list all his sins. I want to thank the Lord for saving me. I want to thank the Lord for forgiving me of my sins, baptizing me in water, and baptizing me in the Holy Spirit. I also want to thank the Lord because I was a womanizer. Man, I used to be with women all the time. Every night, a different woman. I used to drink, and I liked Budweiser or Tecate or whatever it was he drank. And we had to hear the list of all his sins. We used to go around singing songs about their sins. As children, we didn't realize what they were doing. They were commemorating what God had done. Now, every once in a while here on a Wednesday night, now we haven't been here on a Wednesday night, I've been a long time, I will say, does anybody have something good they want to share? In the 20 years I've been pastoring the church, not one person has stood up and said, I want to thank the Lord for saving me of my sins, forgiving me of my sins, washing me in the blood, baptizing me in the waters and in the Holy Ghost. Not one time. If we can't commemorate our salvation, what's bigger than that? Before the day is over, tell somebody your salvation story. Tell somebody your salvation story. And parents, ask your kids, have you given your life to Jesus? Have you prayed the sinner's prayer? Parents, ask your children, tell me when you did it. Michael, he just said it. BBS 2005. He was 3. No, you were by 6. By then, he was 6. But he remembers praying the sinner's prayer and asking God into his heart. Mom remembers the Bible lesson. It's so beautiful. I remember my Sunday school teacher, the hermana Petrita Hernandez from Kennewick. Pobrecita, my wife said. Hermana Petrita Hernandez. Man, she had like 7 daughters. Sometimes we'd have to take her home after church. Why don't we do that anymore? Bring people to church and take them home after church. Well, right now, maybe we shouldn't. But the Jewish people were told, you must celebrate this great deliverance. So I started studying the feasts in the Bible. And I'm thinking that Daniel, me, Mark, they're going to get together and preach these feasts to you over the next 7 weeks. They have 7 major feasts that they have to celebrate. It's part of their religion to celebrate when they were delivered from God. And they have 7 major feasts. And there's a whole bunch of minor feasts. They sound like Mexicans. Because Mexicans celebrate quinceañeras, bautismos, dedications, visitas. They just can't. I mean, they have parties for everything. They celebrate Friday. It's Friday. Let's celebrate. Actually, the Jewish people celebrate Friday. It's called the Sabbath. They celebrate from Friday afternoon till Sunday afternoon. They celebrate the Sabbath. I think about this and I said, when's the last time you celebrated? Now, God bless our governor. And I really like the tone that he had on Thursday. He had a really good tone about what he shared on Thursday. And you know what? We might disagree with him on a lot of things. But when he put us in lockdown 2 weeks before New York, it saved a lot of people's lives. But he said, this is what he said. Please do not gather with people that do not live in your household this 4th of July. He goes, it's imperative that you don't do that. And there's a lot of people that got upset. Who's he to tell me I can't celebrate at my house? He didn't say you couldn't celebrate at your house. What he said was don't celebrate with people you don't live with. Now understand this. If you have a problem say, if you said these words, well, then I can't celebrate. Why can't you celebrate the people in your house? What's wrong with you? Well, you don't know the people in my house. I know you. I know you. These 14 days, Michael and I, we literally went in the backfield, grabbed a hoe and grabbed a rake and carved out a big round circle. We put down this green carpet. We dug a hole. We put a flag in it. We got our golf clubs and started walking the other way, and we started hitting to that golf pin. Michael and I would have never done that had we not been quarantined, because he's a really busy guy. He works out. He eats right. He has a lot of friends. He's really sociable, and he's got a girlfriend. So I would have never gotten to do that with my son. But we had time together, and my goodness, everything's a competition with this young man. Because he's a Garza. He has half Garza in him. And that's something that's in them. Amen, Danny? Amen. Praise the Lord, Danny said. Very competitive. If you can't celebrate with your loved ones, if you can't celebrate with your family, you need to ask God to come into your heart and save you. I believe celebration starts with our family. You don't have to be extravagant like me. I put up 14 flags yesterday and put up a bunch of stuff and just sat there and looked at it. It was really hot. I'd get in the water and then I was hot in the water. Then I'd get out and I was cold. It was weird. But I want you to understand something. Mordecai said, from this day forward, from the 14th and the 15th day of Aram, we will celebrate the deliverance of God. When's the last time you celebrated your deliverance? When's the last time you told the story of your salvation to somebody? My kids will ask me, Dad, you remember you got saved just like them in vacation? Thank God for vacation Bible school. In Sunday school, I used to get saved a lot. Because everybody would lay hands on me and say, he needs Jesus. And I was like, I have Jesus. Literally, deacons would pick me up and shake me and say, you need Jesus. I'd kick them wherever my feet were. We need to celebrate our salvation, our independence from freedom. And more than ever, we need to celebrate our freedom from COVID-19. Some of you, it is the hand of God keeping you. It is the hand of God keeping you right now. And you need to say, thank you, God, for keeping me free from that. David and I, we were at a party where 7 people got sick, David. Thank God for his mercy on us. God for his mercy on my family. He's kept us free. I want to pray for you that God would give you a spirit of celebration. That he give you a spirit of just commemorating the great things he has done. Let me just remind you, those celebrations don't just happen. You got to work at it. You got to put in the time. Lord, I thank you. We're all going to fall on our knees. We're all going to put our face in the mattress or in the pillow and cry out to you. It's either going to happen because we love you, or it's going to happen because we need you. I pray you would put inside of us a spirit of thanksgiving and celebration, that we would just constantly be giving you honor and giving you glory and giving you praise. And when something bad comes, we still say, well, praise the Lord anyway. We look at Esther and Mordecai's story and we see what happened, Lord. And Mordecai told the people, don't ever forget what God did for you. Well, Lord, I pray we would never forget our day of independence from sin. Yes, we sin every day, but now we're washed in the blood of the Lamb and there's forgiveness and mercy. We no longer live in it because of you. Thank you. God, I thank you for the people that are watching by TV right now and the people that are in this house. If they were ever hear the word from God today, tell them, celebrate what I've done for you. Work for it. Work for it. Pray, fast. And when it happens, give God glory. And never forget what he's done. I know these last 7 days or 8 days in my house were a little testy, a little edgy. Have it? Do we not have it? And I can be honest and say I drew a little closer to God this week than I was last week. God, let us not draw closer to you out of fear, but out of thanksgiving and love. God, if there's somebody watching by TV right now who hasn't given his life to Jesus, who hasn't prayed the sinner's prayer and said, Jesus, come into my heart, forgive me of my sin, I want to live for you, I pray he would do it and be able to say, on the weekend of 4th July 2020, I gave my life to Jesus. And every 4th of July from then forward, he would be able to celebrate, or she would be able to celebrate, when I gave my life to Christ in 2020, 4th of July weekend. God, help us all share our story. In the name of Jesus Christ, I pray. Amen. I want to thank you guys for being here and wearing your mask. Before the service started, I told Mark to get up and make an announcement that you had to wear your mask, and he wouldn't do it. I told him, go talk to this guy. There was a guy here without a mask, and we didn't know him. He wasn't part of us. And I told Mark, you have a more pastoral temperament. You're a nice guy. Go tell him. And Mark said, nope, you're the pastor. You go. So I got up on the microphone, and I said, masks are now required by the governor. You have to put it on. And this gentleman walked out. I want to thank you. It's not hard to wear it, and then when you need to take a deep breath, take it, put it back down, and put it back up. But I want to thank you for respecting our wishes and being here. You heard all the announcements. You know what's going on. On your way out, if you want to leave an offering or a tithe, you're welcome to do that. Please come forward. If you're the kind that like to meander and hang around, just stay 6 feet apart. Thank you for being here. God bless you. We'll see you guys on Zoom really soon or on YouTube. God bless you. Those on YouTube, God bless you. Thank you for being with us.